So now we come to Roche, and Dr. Pintoff gave us an insight in your in your pipeline, in the Roche pipeline. So the floor is yours.
Okay, so first of all, I want to thank the organizers for inviting me, giving you a bird's eye view at this at our pipeline. My name is Jan Pintoff. I'm leading the medical teams at Roche for lung cancer, dermato-oncology, quite two indications that are where something's going on, you know, with a cancer immunotherapy in regards to a cancer immunotherapy. So let me start with, as I said, with a bird's eye view to our pipeline. I think all of you know the molecules that are already launched. Most of you are familiar with the programs or with the molecules that are now in phase three. But as you can see, there are 9 new molecular entities and 8 additional indications in a phase two setting. And of course, I don't want to withhold your view at the phase one and phase two a little bit in detail without really diving deep into this. Because this might take actually some time. What I want to draw your attention at is that first we have through all the phases of the clinical development, there is a strong focus on hematology oncology. You can see this here. The products and these indications are marked with the orange squares. And as you can see here, perhaps, like some of you might see this, the ones with the good eyes, that there are already a lot of combinations within the cancer immunotherapy section. So I'll come to that back later. So this just to give you an imagination of how the pipeline looks, although the format changed a little bit. Sorry for that. So talking about pipeline, oncology, hematology pipeline at this time means, of course, talking about cancer immunotherapy. No questions. That's what my fellow colleagues also were mentioning. And I just want to show you the molecule that is the most advanced in our cancer immunotherapy pipelines, atezolizumab. It's a humanized IgG1 antibody directed against anti-PD-L1, thus, of course, inhibiting the PD-L1-PD-1 interaction and the PD-L1-B7-1 interaction being CD80. What it doesn't do is it doesn't affect the PD-L2-PD-1 interaction, thus having theoretically and potentially some advances when it comes to preserving the peripheral immune homeostasis and also theoretically by preventing autoimmune reactions, you know, like mediated via RGMB in the lung. So these are theoretical advantages that this has not been shown in phase three studies. The two lead indications we are developing atezolizumab in is lung cancer. Here I want to focus on non-small cell lung cancer, although we have programs also in with small cell lung cancer and urogenital malignancies. And here I want to focus on bladder cancer. So I think there are quite some clinicians here in the room, so I do not withhold you the clinical data that has been presented at this year's ECC. Let me start with NSCLC, with a poplar study. You all might be familiar with the design. It's a phase two study randomized for patients with metastasized non-small cell lung cancer that have progressed on prior platinum-based therapy, randomized to atezolizumab versus standard of care in second-line docetaxel. And also high-level results for the ITT population. I do not want to go into details about the different PD-L1 expressors. So what we can see here is a median overall survival of 12.6 months for the ITT population. Notably, it's 15.5 for the adenocarcinomas, with the response rates ranging from 18% to 33% and duration of response of 14.3 months. So quite some impressive results and in line what we've seen for the PD-1 inhibitors. The second indication, bladder cancer, I want to talk about. The ones who are working in clinic know that the second line setting in bladder cancer after platinum-based chemotherapy is quite desperate. At least that is what I remember from my clinical practice. So here we have a phase two study, single arm, for patients in second line who progressed on platinum-based chemotherapy. And right now, what do we have for these patients? We have vinflunine that's approved in Europe, not even in the United States, and we have response rates between 8% and 9%. So here we have for the ITT population, median overall survival of approximately 8 months, and a response rate ranging from 18% to 27%, with 15% for the ITT population. These are quite impressive results, but actually, is this good enough for immunotherapy? We think we can go one step beyond. We and others think we should go one step beyond. And how can we optimize immunotherapy? I think the way we think this should happen is by combining the agents we have and the agents we potentially have in our pipeline. So an example for this, combination of a PD-L1 inhibitor plus chemotherapy is taken from also from this year's ESMO, or ECC, sorry. It's a phase 1b study, and I'm showing you the results for the NSCLC cohorts. And what I want to draw your attention at is first the response rate. You see at the bottom of the slide, it's going up to 76%, which is not bad for the combination. But the other thing is the duration of response. And you see that some patients really are on therapy for approximately 420 days, which is also quite impressing, I think. But the combination with chemotherapy is like, this is one way to combine. Here I'm showing you a picture you all know. We all see it like on every Congress in the last 3 years. Anyway, it's the cancer immunity cycle. And here I would like you to focus on the different checkpoints we have for the anti-tumor response of the immune system. And what this means for us as a drug manufacturer is that we have a lot of possibility to modify and to modulate this response. And here also, not going into detail, I'm going to tell you why some of these molecules are marked in green, because these are the molecules that are actually in clinical development. So we have studies running with these molecules, be it phase 1 or phase 2 studies. And the ones in orange are actually the ones being in preclinical development. And you see there are quite some interesting molecules here, some bispecific antibodies, some immune modulators in the priming activation checkpoint at the antigen presentation checkpoint. And of course, that's what I just showed you before at the antigen release point, you know, combination with chemotherapy, targeted agents, and so on. So there's really a lot. There's really a lot we can combine, and there are really a lot of ways we can optimize this therapy for our patients. And bearing this in mind, I want to show you the Roche cancer immunotherapy pipeline right now. And you see, we have combinations like on the left side. You see the combinations of an immune agent with targeted therapy. And you see molecules you know very well, like Selboraft, Tarceva, Avastin, but also azacitidine and lenalidomide. So the IMiDs and epigenetic modulators are also part of the program. And in the second column, you see the combination of immuno plus immuno agent. And I think these are really interesting combination, especially for me. I like the Atezo plus anti-OX40 combination, which has really shown great preclinical results which has a lot of potential in my mind. And to summarize my talk, which was really like a very, very bird's eye view and very, very fast tour de force through our pipeline, we think that the way to optimize is to combine, and these combinations have to be based on a robust basic science knowledge. So I think we are on the right way, we and others are on the right way, and like if this would have happened during the time I was in clinic, I would have been really, really happy actually. So that's it for now, thank you for your attention.
Thanks very much, Dr. Pintoffel, for your excellent presentation. questions? Professor von Kalle?
This may be a bit of a painful question, but probably also to your other colleagues, when you are considering combinations, are you taking into account drugs from other pipelines as well?
Yeah, we are having actually collaborations with other companies, because we know that the topic is too important to just take the, like, we are having the advantage that we have really a broad portfolio to pick off. But we are also having collaborations. We are having collaborations with companies manufacturing vaccines, manufacturing other molecules. Yes. So we have a big partnering team who are actually looking at possibilities to partner.
Again, thank you.
I have just a quick question.
Please.
Roche is recognized as a company that does the pharmaceuticals plus diagnostic products. What is going on in the other pipeline, in the diagnostic part?
Well, as you know, we are quite strictly separated. But anyway, of course, we are looking into assays measuring PD-L1 expression on an immunochemistry basis, but immunohistochemistry basis. But we also know that this might perhaps not be the last word in biomarkers. So we are also looking deeper into mutational load and everything. But I can't tell you what exactly we have in the pipeline there. But anyway, I would have to go back and talk to my colleagues actually. Sorry.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.